I was doing a gig in Brighton and was put up in a quaint old Regency townhouse that had been lovingly restored and turned into a small, very luxurious hotel run by a couple, Mark and Peter, who had done much of the work themselves. Mark, I remember, wore a long leather apron in which to conduct his housekeeping duties. Chattily, he showed me to the room, not long after which Jane arrived, having come from London by train to meet up with me. Mark asked us if we'd like anything brought to the room. He really was very thoughtful and took great delight in telling us all about how he and Peter had renovated the place, how long it had taken, who chose the fabric for the soft furnishings, Mark mostly, although the drawing room curtains were Peter's idea. In bed, I realise that the air conditioning is a bit loud, but I can't figure out where to switch it off. I have to call Mark, who doesn't know but says that Peter will because he's a wizard at that sort of thing and was in on the electrical design, so he'll ask him. Mark, I don't know why people bother doing this, puts his hand over the receiver, and so I hear a muffled version of my question being asked, followed by a fainter and even more muffled answer from Peter. Mark interprets, and so I look where I'm instructed to. Peter, the electrical wizard, had decided that the switch for the air conditioning should be located behind the bed. Not without effort, I pull the bed away from the wall so that I can squeeze my arm in and reach the control with the tip of my finger. Having turned it off, I get back into bed and lie there. The lack of hum from the AC is nice, but it has revealed a second underlying noise. Jane says that it sounds like a running tap. "Go and look," she says. It appears to be coming from the lavatory, which is in that mood where the system won't shut up. I often find that if you flush it again, that seems to placate it, and all becomes quiet, so I tiptoe in. "What are you doing?" asks Jane. "I'm going to..." "Oh, it doesn't matter," I explain, as I flush the lever. "That's made it noisier," decides Jane. "I know, but once it's filled up again, it should..." "We can't have it like that all night. You'd better call Mark again," she says. "No," I insist, "because it should stop again in a minute when the system fills." 2 competitive minutes pass, the tension of right or wrong rising like the water in the cistern. I was wrong. "It hasn't stopped." "I know," I say. "Call Mark, but I really don't want to." "I really don't want to," I say. "I've already called him about the air conditioner. He's going to think I'm some sort of pain." Jane called Mark anyway. Thankfully, there was no answer, so I was spared from that humiliation. And then I uttered the words that should be confined to professional tradesmen and lame sitcom scripts. "I'll try and fix it." The trouble with this particular cistern is that it was a very bad design. The stopcock was inaccessible because the porcelain lid that concealed it was glued on. Madness. It's lucky that I'm quite practical and strong. With force, I could feel the lid begin to give. It was partially recessed into the wall and still wet from my all-encompassing shower, which made it hard to get a grip. I called out to Jane, asking her to pass me a dry towel from the bedroom, but there was no reply. She must have gone to sleep. Still straining at the cistern cover, I reached for the bathrobe on the back of the door to use instead. At that moment, the cover came loose. Well, more than loose. It sort of took off. The seal that was holding it stuck just gave way, and the cover launched itself with all the force that I was exerting upon it. It literally flew up into the air like a piece of paper caught by the wind. This heavy white lump of china. I so nearly caught it as well, but as I said, it was wet and slippery, which is why I was reaching for the bathrobe in the first place, and it evaded my fingers, took a sizable chunk out of the adjacent basin, and smashed into small pieces on the stone-tiled floor. Luckily, Jane hadn't stirred, although I'm sorry to report that I said a few things that in this day and age could get you suspended from the beeb. Things got worse as I realised that damage had also been done to the bowl of the lavatory, which appeared to have suffered a crack. Better not use it just yet, I thought. Which was a pity, because what with all the excitement and the 2 pints I'd had earlier trickling their way through my system, I was bursting for the loo. But as I said, the cistern cover had cracked it, and I didn't want to add to the problem by filling it further and causing it to leak. My other worry was the shards of porcelain that I was increasingly aware of and trying to avoid. The best thing, I decided, was to stand where I was and try to aim at the hole in the floor which served as a drain for the shower. It was about a meter away. I'd say that the first pint went to plan. I doubt McDonald's had this in mind when they came up with their marketing idea of a golden arch, but that's what it reminded me of. However, as the pressure in my bladder diminished, so too did the manly force of my stream, until I was left trying to calculate which part of the floor would best create a downward path for the remaining flow. Inevitably, this necessitated a degree of trial and error, and to an onlooker, I admit, this could very well have appeared as though I was deliberately, casually urinating all over the broken pieces of lavatory. Well, here's the thing. It turned out that Jane hadn't been asleep at all. In fact, she wasn't even in the bedroom. She had taken it upon herself to go downstairs and fetch Mark. I heard a small cough behind me, and still peeing on the floor, turned to see Mark, Peter, and Jane watching. It's fair to say that the next morning there was a bit of an atmosphere at breakfast. Anyway, please don't think that their businesses suffered as a result of my misfortune. I tried to book a room there recently, and Peter told me they were fully booked. Forever.